Well, welcome. We have a smaller group, but thank God for technology, and hopefully this will get out to lots of people on YouTube and other ways and bless people in the future. So my name is Teresa Carter, and I am filling in today for Erica Miller, who generally runs the kids ministry. And this children's ministry here at Hardcore Christianity is really personal to my husband and I, because it's been such a blessing to our kids. We have an older daughter, Madison, and Presley, who's 12, and they go on a Sunday call with Erica, and she teaches them about spiritual warfare, and which is, I think, such a cool part about Hardcore Christianity, that we come here to get deliverance, but also to be trained up in spiritual warfare, so that once we get free, we can stay free, because that's the bigger goal, right? So we are so thankful for the mighty ways that the Lord has used Erica and Hardcore Christianity and the Children's Deliverance to help our daughters and help our family. So I'm just going to open in prayer, and then we'll get started. So Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for the people here, Lord, for the children, for the parents, for the people who have come to serve and pray for people, Lord. We pray ahead of time for the people that will see this in the future, Lord. We pray that it blesses them. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that you're a God that we can trust, Lord, that we can come to you. Lord, we thank you for your grace and your mercy, Lord, and we just pray that you imprint it on all of our hearts, Lord, to look at where our walk is with you, Lord, and how much we're trusting you, Lord. And we just pray that you speak to us today, and we thank you that we can gather in your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So today we are going to talk about trusting in Jesus. And really, trusting in Jesus is the foundation of our Christian walk, right? If we think about it. If we're not trusting in Jesus, we're certainly not going to be obeying him. We're not going to be worshiping him. We're not going to be seeking him for wisdom and guidance, right? I wanted everyone to think about, I had an idea of a little exercise, but there's not a ton of kids that can write on the board besides Presley. So I just want you to think about for a minute somebody in your life that you can trust, that you felt like you've been able to trust before. Maybe it's a parent, maybe it's a close friend or a coworker, someone like that. And I want you to think about what makes you trust them. What characteristics do they have that allow you to trust in them? So think about that. And I want to open with Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6. And Presley, would you mind reading that for us? But you got to read it really loud, okay? So people online can hear.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight.
Awesome. So the book of Proverbs gives us a lot of gives us wisdom, right? And direction on how to live a life that's pleasing to God. And I underlined a couple things in here when I was reading through this. Erica and Presley came up with this verse to open with, and I was looking at it and praying on it, and a couple things stuck out to me. And the main thing was all, right? All. All means you're all in. It means 100%, right? It's not sometimes, you know, it doesn't say trust in the Lord with some of your heart and lean not on your own understanding, right? It says all. So that means that's a very definitive word. We're all in on that. So trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him. Again, not some of our ways, right? We don't get to pick and choose when we're going to submit to the Lord, right? Some of us do, and I think that's, we are led astray and things go bad for us. So lean not on your own understanding. That doesn't mean that we're, hi, welcome, hi. So leaning on our own understanding, you know, we have a very narrow lens, right? We can only see what's in front of us. Whereas God can see, hi, come on in, welcome. No, that's okay, we just got started. We're just on the first slide. We're happy to have you guys. So we are talking today about trusting in the Lord, right? And Presley just read for us Proverbs 3, 5 through 6 that says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your path straight, right? Again, that's another word that's very, very certain, will. It doesn't say he might make our path straight, right? It says he will make our path straight. Another thing that I thought of is I thought, what does that mean to make your path straight? Anybody have any ideas what that might mean? Does it mean that everything's going to be perfect and we're never going to have any problems and we're going to get everything we want and life's going to be so easy?
Then by choosing that, that honors God.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. That's what I was going to say. So it means that he'll direct our path. He's going to lead us down the right path where he sees us, right? He's going to guide us. Because we were just saying, when we lean on our own understanding, we just can't, as humans, we can't fully grasp what lies ahead. Whereas we serve a God that is present, right? He goes before us and he's here with us, right? So he knows. He knows what's best for us. So when he's going to make our path straight, that means he's going to send us. And it's a narrow path, right? It's a narrow path. So he'll make our path straight. He'll send us down the right direction. And I have some notes here because I just want to make sure I don't forget anything. So forgive me if I'm looking down. But so making our path straight means that he's going to lead us where he wants us to go. So when I'm thinking about who I trust, I was thinking about who are some of the people I trust? And I had asked everybody before you guys came in about, think about somebody that you trust in your life. If it's your mom or a friend or a teacher. And I asked people to think about what makes you trust that person, right? What makes you trust that person? So if someone was just telling us about Jesus and we're thinking, oh, about this Jesus guy, can I trust him? We want to look at somebody's character, right? Anybody know what character is? What's somebody's character? Anybody know? You have any ideas, Press? No? Is it their attributes, right? Their qualities, the way they think and behave, okay? And when we are looking to find out about Jesus, about who Jesus is, where are we going to look? Where's our source that we want to look? Anybody know? We want to look in like magazines or Google or any other ideas where we might look? Go ahead.
The Bible,
right? The Bible. So we want to look to the Bible. In 2 Timothy, it states that all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. It's God breathed. We can trust that, right? It's a blessing that we have. It's a manual for us on how to live our lives and to answer all the questions that we have. So we want to look to the Bible. So some of this is not an exhaustive list. I could only fit a few on here. We could probably go on for days and days about the character of God, right? But the character of Jesus, the Bible says that Jesus is, he's humble, right? He's humble. He's compassionate. He's forgiving, very forgiving, right? He is quick to forgive us. And this is an example we need to be led by, right? Unforgiveness, what happens when we don't forgive people? Which is a big part of deliverance about getting free, right? What happens when we don't forgive people? Anybody have any ideas? No? So unforgiveness is one of the easiest ways to be tormented. Has anybody ever had that happen? Where someone does something wrong to you, and maybe it wasn't something very nice to do to you, right? Maybe someone did something unkind, and we're angry and feeling frustrated, and we know we're like, oh, the Bible says I have to forgive, but oh, they were just so mean, I don't think I want to. What happens to us? We get angry, right? Our hearts are sad. And it affects us, right? We get tormented by that. And you think of the ultimate example, you know, Jesus, how much he forgave. He forgives us for little things, for big things. He even asked his Father to forgive the people that were crucifying him, right? That's pretty good example of forgiving, right? So he's very forgiving. He's loving. Loving, like we just talked about, he died on the cross for us, right? So that our sins could be forgiven and we can be reconciled with God and spend eternity in heaven. That's, talk about love, right? Pretty good example of love. He had said, I wrote down, he conquered sin and death so that we can have eternal life with him. And that's just the ultimate showing of love. He's patient. I don't know about you guys, but I know he's been patient with me. I can think back. There's a lot of things that I think about that he's probably saying, oh my goodness, Teresa. But he's patient. He's so patient with us because he loves us, right? But we can't abuse his patience. That's something that we have to realize. He's self-controlled. He's a perfect example of being self-controlled. He's sinless. He's the only person, right, to walk this earth that's been sinless. So he's got self-control. He's gentle and peaceful. He brings us peace, right? He gives us the Holy Spirit that fills us with his peace, and he's complete peace. So to go back, when we look at just some of these, like I said, this is just a short list. Does this sound like somebody that we might be able to trust? Yeah, I'm thinking, yeah, right? So another thing about God's character, God cannot lie. These are some really cool scriptures. And when we think about how easy it is for us as humans, our sinful nature, to tell little lies, right? Some of them are big lies. Some are little lies. But Hebrews, I'm going to move this. I can't even see it. Hebrews 6:18. Press, do you want to read these for me?
These two things cannot change. God cannot lie when he makes a promise, and he cannot lie when he makes an oath. These things encourage us who have come to God for safety to give us strength to hold on to the hope we have to be given.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, these two things cannot change, right? God, the cool thing about God is he's the same yesterday, today, and always, right? So he's not going to change. Sometimes we change. Our friends change, right? People change. God does not change. So he's not lying to us. When he makes a promise, he keeps it, right? And he gives us lots of promises. If we're trusting in him, he'll fulfill all those promises, right? And then in Numbers 23:19, it said, God is not a man that he might lie, or a son of man that he might change his mind. Does he speak and not act? Or promise and not fulfill? He talks the talk and walks the walk, right? Yeah. How many times have we promised something or told someone we were going to do something and then we haven't fulfilled that, right? Yeah, not God. So I thought those were really important because we have to realize that God cannot lie. So when we read about God's promises and what he says about us, when he's telling us who he sees us as, he's not lying to us, right? So we can have, that just builds his character. Okay, so now we know that we can trust Jesus. Sounds like someone we can trust, but is it always easy to trust him? No, nope, definitely not. If anybody tells you it's always easy, they're probably a liar, right? So it's not always easy to trust. There's some things that are easy to trust, right? Some things are easier than others. And it's easy for us to say, yeah, we're going to trust in Jesus. We know that's what the Bible says. But then things happen, right, where we think, oh my goodness, is he really going to come through? Is that promise really true? And then what happens when we get doubt in our minds, right? So when we get doubt in our minds, we end up trusting other sources, other people, right? So if we're not trusting in Jesus, anybody have any ideas on who we might be trusting? Huh?
Satan.
Satan. But first, we might be trusting in ourselves. Anybody ever trusted in themselves? Me, for sure, right? And it didn't end up so good. So when we're trusting in ourselves, we have, like I said before, we have this narrow lens. It's not that we're dumb people. We're human. And so we can only see so far ahead, right? And again, God goes before us. He knows everything, right? He knows what's good for us. So when we trust in ourselves, we can't see the big picture like God can, right? And remember that back in the first slide in Proverbs 3, it said, lean not on your own understanding. And there's a reason for that, right? Again, it's not that we're not intelligent and we're not, but we can't lean just on our own understanding because there are some things that we are not going to understand. I'm sure of it. We're not going to. When we are trusting in ourself, we're focused on ourself, right? So if we're focused on self, some things that I was thinking of is that if we trust in ourselves and we're just so self-absorbed, let's say we get caught doing something. Are we sad or sorry that we got caught? Because we don't want to get in trouble or we don't want to face the consequences? Or are we sad that we hurt God, right? Probably not. We probably don't have godly sorrow when we're trusting in ourselves and concerned about ourselves, right? Then we won't have godly sorrow. If we're not trusting in Jesus, we might be trusting in others, in man, right? And in Jeremiah 17, it says, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, right? We can't be getting our trust and our strength from anybody outside of Jesus, right? Some things when we might be getting our trust from friends, right? When we're saying, hey, we're not seeking God, we're not going to prayer, we're not looking to the Bible, we're just asking other people. And what's even worse is a lot of times we're asking people that aren't strong Christians, right? So it is okay. It's okay to have people in your life that you trust that are strong Christian friends. That's why it's so important, and the Bible tells us we need to surround ourselves by strong Christians, right? A cloud of great witnesses, because those friends are going to help give us good direction and lead us back towards Jesus, right? So we have to remember that God is our ultimate security, and our trust in man should never be over God. So we might go to friends and say, hey, what do you think about that, or things like that, but God has the ultimate say, right? We need to be trusting in Jesus for all those things. We need to be seeking the Lord in all things, big and small. It's important to have strong Christian friends, like I said, that you can trust to give you good biblical advice and to warn us when we're in error, when we're not doing something right, right? If you tell your friend, hey, I'm thinking it'd be really easy to just cheat on that test, no one's going to know, right? Well, a good Christian friend then would tell you, hey, we're not supposed to do that. That's a sin. We can't do that. You don't want to do that. Think about the consequences. Okay, the last one, the devil. So if we are trusting anybody besides Jesus, we're really trusting in the devil, right? The devil is okay with us trusting ourselves. He wants us to trust ourselves, right? Because he knows it's going to a straight shot to nowhere. It's not going to go good, right? So the devil will use other people. Everybody know that? So the devil will use news outlets. If we're trusting in the news, if you watch the news, there is no way you're not affected by that, right? There's no possible way. So he'll use the news, the music industry, entertainment, right? To try and tell us like how, hey, this is the way you should get your worth, what you look like and how much money you have and who your friends are and the shoes you have, right? So politicians, right? If we're putting our trust in politicians, and that's a big one, right? We know in our country, that's a big, there's some turmoil there. There's divide. And Satan wants nothing more than to cause division, right? That's where he wins. That's where he's excited, is when he can cause division. So he will use anybody he can to lead us away from Jesus, right? And then, because he knows he's going to be pretty successful. So anybody have any ideas? What's one of the number one ways that the devil tries to place doubt or get us away from trusting in Jesus? Because that's his ultimate goal, right? Any ideas? It's pretty simple. Fear. And how does he get fear into us? A lot of different ways, but one of them, it's super simple. So in our mind, right? He'll just give us some thoughts, right? He'll give us thoughts. So negative thoughts, fearful thoughts, they're all lies, right? So it might be something super subtle. Like it might be like you're feeling good about going to school and then, you know, he'll bring in a thought, well, oh, your outfit's stupid. Or no one's going to want you on their team. Or this person's better than I am. Or you're going into an interview, well, probably not good enough for that job, right? He'll give us these little thoughts, right? And that's okay if he's given us those thoughts, but where we get into big, big trouble is when we entertain those thoughts, right? We entertain those thoughts and we're like, oh, yeah, probably nobody does want me on their team. I might as well not try out, right? Or nobody is going to want to hang out with me. I might as well not go. Or nobody's going to want to listen to me today. I shouldn't go talk about Jesus, right? Devil tries any way he can. So those are all lies. That's how he gets us. He wants us to believe those lies. Okay, so now it's only fair. We looked at the character of Jesus. We got to look at the character of the devil, right? So again, this is another one. This is just a small list. We could go through probably hours and hours of all the ways who the devil is. But the Bible says that Satan is a liar, right? Scripture refers to him as the father of lies. And actually, Presley, can you read for us John 8:44? Can you read it really loud?
You are the father of the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of
the devil. Yeah. He's a liar, right? And he wants us to believe his lies, because then we don't like ourselves. We're not seeing, if we're believing Satan's lies, we're not seeing ourselves the way that Jesus wants us to, right? He's a thief. He's a thief. What does he steal from us? Or what does he want to steal? Yeah. Our joy, our peace, our friendships, our relationship. He wants to steal everything, right? If we're having a good day and we're feeling good, he wants to steal it. He doesn't like that. He hates us. Do you know that? That's a really strong word. I know when I was growing up, my parents would say, don't say that word. It's a really strong word. But he does. He hates us. He's evil. He is so evil, right? He takes pleasure in harming others, right? He's a tempter. What does that mean? You know what that means?
Something wrong or something that would hurt you.
Yeah. He wants to tempt us. He wants to persuade us to do wrong because he knows that's not pleasing to the Father, right? So he wants to wreak havoc in our relationship with Jesus. So how does he do it? How does he tempt us?
Making it seem like it's fun.
Yeah.
Without consequence.
Yeah. Yeah. Getting us to doubt too, right? Or getting us to think. Just like, how did he tempt Eve at the beginning, right? He's like, well, did God really say that? Is that really what he meant? I don't think that's probably really what he meant, right?
You can like twist God's words.
Yes. Yes. The devil, that's good. Presley said twisting God's words, because you want to know who knows scripture? The devil. He knows it, right? So he'll twist God's words. So he'll say, well, you know, everybody else is doing really bad things. If you just tell a little lie, who cares? Nobody's going to find out. If you just cheat on a test or you cheat in the game, Who cares, right? He tempts us. Say, oh, it'll be so much easier. You'll have more time. Things will be better. People will like you. He makes it desirable. He wants it to seem desirable to do wrong. So I wrote down here that he gives us thoughts. And like we talked about before, it's okay if he gives us thoughts, but we have a choice, right? We have a choice. If we entertain them and we act on them, then boom, right? He's got us right where he wants us. So the good news about this is that the Bible says that if we are following Jesus, God is faithful and he will not allow us to be tempted beyond what we can bear. So, but when we are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that he can endure it. And actually, do you want to read that scripture, Presley? It's 1 Corinthians 10 through 13. Read it really loud.
No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it.
Yeah. So he always gives us a way of escape, right? Think all of us here, especially the adults, can think back on times where we've made some really, really bad decisions and gotten ourselves in some really, really tough spots. And then what's the way out? What's the way out? We can repent, right? We can repent and we can turn away. It doesn't mean just stop, you know, saying I'm sorry. We got to actually change our behavior. We got to repent and turn away and ask God to help us. So God will always give us a way out. So keep that in mind. Because that's another lie that Satan will tell you. Oh, it's too far. That's too bad. You too bad now. You're done. God's not going to help you. Well, he will. Doesn't mean it's going to be easy or the problem's just going to go away. There might be some consequences we have to face, right? But he'll help us. He's a murderer. What does the Bible say that Satan's ultimate goal is?
Steal,
kill, and destroy. And when we think about how intense that is, how awful that someone's main goal, that's what brings him pleasure. He loves nothing more. He's a murderer. He wants to get us in our sin, and if we keep going in our sin, where does it lead us? To death, right? So he's a murderer. All those things, abortion, murder, things like that, he delights in those things. He's prideful. What's the problem with pride? What does the Bible say about pride? Pride alienates us from God, right? It's all about self. Self, you can be whoever you want to be and, you know, be proud of yourself and, you know, things like that. So it's taking the emphasis off of who we are in God's eyes and just to our own self. We can do whatever we want to do, be whoever we want to be, you know. We are our own destiny. You hear a lot of New Age things like that, like all about self. But really, it's alienating us from God. And when we focus on self, that's exactly opposite of what God says we need to do, right? We need to be focused on a relationship with him and seeking him.
If you don't mind.
Yeah.
He's asking, what does to be alienated mean?
Oh, so to be alienated, it means to take someone away. Right? He wants to take us away from God. He wants us to not be thinking about how much Jesus loves us and how much he cares about us and all the good things. He wants to say, you don't need God, right? He wants to get us away, right?
Separate.
Yeah, he wants to separate us from God. Because he
back in time, then he was an angel, and then he was selfish.
You're right. You're right. Yeah, that's where it came in. That's what we were just saying, self, right? He was concerned about himself. He wanted to be stronger than God, more powerful, right? Yeah, you're right. More important, yeah. When you're full of pride, you want everyone to know that you're important, right? Yeah, that's really good. Thanks for sharing that. He's a destroyer. That kind of speaks for itself, right? He wants to destroy things. He wants to destroy our families, our friendships, our jobs, our marriages. He wants to destroy everything. And one thing I want to bring up about Satan, too, is You know, I've had my kids in the past have brought up, I have an older daughter too, and said, well, you know, so-and-so's, you know, they're Muslim or they're atheist or they're, they seem like they're having a pretty good life, right? But here's the thing about Satan. If somebody is already drawing themselves away from God, he doesn't need to waste his time there, right? He's going to let them have a seemingly good life, right? So sometimes what we're seeing on the outside, well, look at what they have. Look at what they have. That's not really what's going on the inside, right? Satan knows that if they're already trusting him and not trusting God, he's not even going to bother his time because they're already destroying themselves, right? So he's a destroyer, so he wants to go after the you know, being a Christian, it's tough, right? Because Satan wants to ruin us. So he wants to destroy us. He's deceitful. He's deceitful. He's a liar. He's a liar. He deceives us. Again, a lot of times it's with our thoughts or things that'll tell us. And he's a slanderer. I was reading about this the other day. A slanderer makes false and damaging statements about someone, right? He wants to slander who we are. He wants to slander our identity. And our identity is what? Rooted in Jesus. Rooted in God, right? When we're Christians, that's our identity. Children of God. So he's a slanderer. He wants to ruin our reputation and our image, right? He's going to set us up and things will be going good for a while. And then he wants to embarrass us and shame us and mock us, right? So that's what we talked about before. Satan's ultimate goal is to steal, kill, and destroy. He hates us, and he will use everything and anyone he can to help in that plan, to accomplish that. So does this sound like somebody we want to trust?
No.
No, right? No way. No way. Okay, so now we know what Jesus's character is like and Satan's character is like. But so we know we should trust in Jesus, but for what reasons? What are some of the things that, how are we going to benefit from trusting in Jesus? And actually, Presley, will you come up? So Presley's my daughter. This is the one I had introduced her a little bit before, but she has been touched by the kids ministry here with Erica Miller and done some great Bible studies and learned a lot about spiritual warfare. So I'm going to have you come up and help me. Do you want to come stand up here? That'd be great. So I'm going to go through these scriptures and then Presley's going to read them, okay? And these are all from the New King James Version. I just like that version. So that's where these are coming from. So we need to trust in Jesus for our salvation, right? Our salvation depends on it, right? Do you want to read John 14:6 for us? Read it nice and loud.
Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Yes, right? That's it. That tells us. Nobody. It's not sometimes. Nobody comes to the Father except through me. So we have to put our trust in him, right? We have to take action and put our trust in Jesus. For our salvation depends on it, so we can spend eternity in heaven. For protection, right? Do you want to read Proverbs 18:10 for us?
The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteousness run to it and are safe.
Yes, yeah. So the Lord is our strong tower. If you think about a strong tower, I have a picture in my head and it's safe, right? There's safety there. So God protects us, right? There's a hedge of protection around us when we're trusting in him. It's a benefit of walking with God. And then blessings. There's a couple I have on here, but will you read Jeremiah 17:7-8 for us?
Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is like the Lord, is the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river, and will not fear when he comes. And its leaf will be green, and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit.
Yeah. So think about what that means. So he wants, God wants to bless us, right? He wants good things for us. He wants us to be filled with joy and peace, and he's going to meet all of our needs. And when you think about in that scripture, the things, there's a really cool song that I love from Corey Asbury, and it talks about that. It's called Sparrows, but it talks about like the birds aren't concerned, right? They're not concerned. They're not anxious and depressed thinking like, where's my food going to come from? God provides all that, right? Just like with the trees, they're not concerned like, oh, it's getting to be 120 degrees. You know, what are we going to do? They're not anxious, right? They're just, God provides. He knows it all, right? So the same thing, we don't need, what that's telling us is that he's going to bless us, and blessings don't mean, oh, we're going to get all the shoes we want and all the great things and everything's going to get answered. It means he's going to meet all of our needs and we don't need to worry about them, right? So that's a pretty great promise. We need to trust in Jesus to fulfill our destiny. And fulfilling our destiny, when we fulfill our destiny, it's by doing the will of the Father, right? But what's the will of the Father? Yeah. Do you have, so do you want to read John 6, 40 for us?
I don't have that one.
Do I not have that one? Do I got John 4? Okay, sorry. So what's the will of the Father? In John 6, verse 40, it says, and this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day. And then in John 4, it says, Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. So the Father's will is that everyone comes to know Jesus, right? That's what he wants for us, so we can be saved and we can live not just for eternity. He wants us to have a good life here too, right? It's not just that's the ultimate is to our salvation, but he wants us to be filled with joy and enjoy this earthly life, right? And be able to go out and tell people about Jesus and help people get set free, which is what we're doing here at the Deliverance Center, right? When we're seeking God and praying and asking for his direction, guidance, and provision, he'll do it, right? He wants to answer those prayers. He wants to do it. He wants good things for us. I think that's really good, important, okay? Because Satan will tell you he doesn't want good things. He just wants you to be lame and you can't do anything when you're a Christian. It's so lame. But that's not true, right? He wants good things for us. Okay, so we got to trust him for our joy, even when trials come, right? It's super easy to be filled with joy when it's like our birthday and we're going to the theme park and it's going to be a really fun day at school or we get to go hang out with friends, right? It's easy to be filled with joy then, but what about trials? What about when someone's sick or something bad happens or you do really bad on a test? Or you don't make a team or something, right? Those are tough things. So would you read, Presley? I think I have Nehemiah 8:10 on there, right? Mm-hmm. Will you read that?
Then he says to them, go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet, and send portions to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord. Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength.
Mm-hmm. So that part right there, so do not sorrow, right? For the joy of the Lord is our strength. So that's when we really count. We got to lean in and get our strength from God, right? Because otherwise, when hard times come, and guess what? Here's the bad part. Here's the downer, is that hard times are going to come, right? Jesus doesn't tell us, he does not promise us. He promises a lot of things, but he doesn't promise that we're not going to have any problems in life, right? There is going to be some hard times. Right? Does everybody here face something hard? Yeah? Right? Yeah, everybody, I would imagine. And that there's another scripture that goes along with that in 1 Thessalonians 5. It says, rejoice always. That's another one of those words like we talked about at the beginning, always. It doesn't say sometimes, right? That's hard to even imagine. But rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and in everything give thanks. So we have to give thanks to God even when times are tough, right? And something that, I had a revelation about several years back was We don't need to be giving thanks that, boy, I'm so glad so-and-so has cancer. I'm so glad that, you know, I got into an accident. But we need to say this happened, and thank you, Lord, that you're here to help me through it. Because now you get to show up for me in ways that I don't know what I'm going to do, right? So it's we give thanks that he's with us to help us through that time, right? And he does every time. Okay, so let's see here. For direction, you want to read John 14:26? Is it on there?
Yeah. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things I have said to you.
Yeah. So, who's our helper? Who's the helper that God sends? The Holy Spirit, right? He gives us the Holy Spirit. So we didn't get to walk around, you know, way back when with Jesus, but he sent the Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit lives in us. So that's our helper. The Holy Spirit will direct us, will direct our ways. But guess what? He can't do it. We have free will. So he can't do it if we're not trusting, right? And we're not yielding and we're not obeying, right? It takes action. So I'm going to talk about this later too, but you know, our faith, so our faith is our belief we have, right? And trusting is the action. That's an action. We have to do that. That's something that we have to do, right? I think a lot of times, and it would be really, really nice if we could just sit around and just wait for everything to happen and just say, all right, Lord, just waiting for you. Sometimes we got to do stuff, right? We still have to work hard. And we have to forgive, and there's lots of things that we have to do. So trusting is an action. So the Holy Spirit will direct our ways. And then for God to hear our prayers. You want to read 1 John? Is that on there?
Oh, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we will have the petitions that we have asked of him.
Yes, perfect. Thank you. You can sit down for a couple minutes if you want. I might ask you to read a couple more at the end. But so for God to hear our prayer, right? He hears our prayers. He hears them. I think the difficult part sometimes as Christians is, you know, we all have probably stories or we can look back on. Sometimes those prayers were answered really quickly. Really quickly, we're like, whoa, and that's so cool, right? That's so awesome. And sometimes I can think of my life when I look back like 10 or 15 years and you're like, whoa, that's how you answered it. And the thing about that is that sometimes he doesn't answer the prayer the way we think it's supposed to go, right? Because again, he knows way more than we do, right? We don't have all the understanding. So we can have confidence. The scripture is telling us that we can have confidence that God hears our prayers, right? And he wants to answer those prayers. But sometimes we have to wait, and that's tough, right? But he's thinking ahead for us. He knows what's best for us. So we have to trust, right? And sometimes it's hard because we can't see things, right? We can't see the Holy Spirit. We can't see God, right? But Satan knows that we can see things here that are tempting us, right? We can see things, so we're more likely to trust those things. So we've got to trust that God hears our prayers. All right, so what happens if we're not trusting in Jesus? So now we know all the good things that happen if we trust in Jesus. But if we're not trusting in Jesus, we will spend eternity separated from God, right? And that is not somewhere we want to be, right? So we want to get to spend eternity when we leave this earth with God in heaven, right? That's the ultimate goal. And guess who doesn't want us to spend eternity with God? Satan, right? So Satan's job here is why we're here on this earth, to do everything he can to get us away from him, right? Because where does he want us to spend eternity? What do you think, Press? In hell, right? Yeah. So we got to put our trust in Jesus. If we're not putting our trust in Jesus, our protection and security is pulled away. We talked about that before, right? That scripture says we have this hedge of protection and God wants to take care of us. But again, we have free will. So he's not going to force us to do anything, right? And so if we're trusting Satan, guess what? That protection's pulled away. If we're not trusting in Jesus, we are easily going to fall into temptations, right? Everything in the world, cheating, lying, doing all the sins, it's going to look really good, right? We're going to be tempted and we're going to get entangled in sin. And it's a slippery slope and it happens quick. You get caught up in sin and pretty soon you look back and you're like, whoa, what just happened? Where am I? And you start to feel helpless and things fall apart, right? When we're not trusting in Jesus, we make decisions on our own. And we were warned about that in Proverbs right at the beginning, right? And destruction happens, right? We can't do it on our own. We can't. We lose our joy and our peace and our comfort, right? When we're not trusting in Jesus, we don't have that joy of the Lord. And you know, you hear stories. I was watching a sermon from an old church that we used to go to, and there was a guy that was, he was a multi-millionaire. I mean, he made like $50 million a year. And he had all the things. He had all the cars, all the trips, everything. And guess what? He didn't know Jesus. He didn't know, and he said, I was so empty. I was so, so empty. So all our earthly success, nothing's going to fill that void. There might be some temporary respite, which is why people get sucked into drugs and alcohol, right? You get a temporary respite. Those demons back off for a little bit. But you're not going to be filled with joy and peace and comfort. And I think all of us that get to be filled with those things because we're trusting Jesus know that that's priceless, right? We have a sound mind when we're trusting in Jesus. If we're not trusting in Jesus, we lose our direction. You know that narrow path? We jump off it and all of a sudden we're just like, there's all these different, we're like, where the heck are we? We don't even know where we are. We lose our direction. And guess what? We can't help others. So if we're not trusting in Jesus and walking out that walk, we can't help others, which is what we're commissioned to do, right? We're commissioned to go out and share the gospel and heal people and help them get set free. But we can't help others if we're in bondage, right? If we're not trusting in Jesus. We might help them in bad ways, right? We're probably going to do more damage. So, all right. So we got a couple slides left, but so we found some examples, Presley and I did, of examples of people who trusted in Jesus. And we've got a little video that we're going to share on Daniel. But anybody remember the story of Daniel, right? When King Nebuchadnezzar, he wants everybody to, he creates this golden statue, and I can't remember how big it was, but it was crazy big. And he wants everybody, when they play the music on his command, he wants them to worship that statue, right? Yeah. And they change their name. So the story, right, it's with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, right? But he says, hey, everybody's got to bow down and worship this statue, which is an idol, a false god. And we can't do that, right? God warns about that. And they said, no way, we're not doing it. We're not doing it. And do you think that was probably super easy? Probably not. That was probably scary, right? Because guess what King Nebuchadnezzar said? If you don't do this, guess what we're going to do? Anybody that doesn't follow my command and worship this false god, we're going to throw them in a fiery furnace. Yikes. I'd probably be pretty scared. But they trusted God. They trusted God and they didn't do it. And guess what happened? We'll watch the video, but they got put in a fiery furnace. Anybody remember that story? And then guess what? King Nebuchadnezzar is like looking in there and he's like, there's four people in there and they're not getting, it even says that the guards were like torched, right? That they got burnt up because they were even close to the fire. It was that hot, right? He told them, crank it up. He was so angry that they wouldn't obey. He cranked it up like seven times hotter, right? And people, the guards that were even going by there to throw them in were getting burned up. But they didn't get burned up. God protected them, right? Because there was, and it shows you in this video, there's a fourth person in the fire with them that kept them safe. Who was that? Yes, Jesus. Yes, that's so cool. Yeah, and then guess what? King Nebuchadnezzar was like, whoa. So then he changed his mind, right? He changed his mind. He was like, wow, you guys trusted and God protected you. And guess what? Now I'm going to change what I'm thinking. So now we're going to trust in that God, right? Okay. And then what about Noah? This is one of my favorite stories. And actually, our family got to go, where is that? Is it in Arkansas?
It's in Kentucky.
Kentucky. Why do I always say Arkansas? To Kentucky to go see the Ark last summer. And it was one of the coolest things I've ever seen. It's a life-size replica of the Ark. And just, I was going to put a picture on here, but my teenage girls didn't want their picture on there. So, anyway, so the story of Noah and the Ark, right? So Noah was a man. He loved God. He trusted God. He obeyed God. And then God showed up, right? And he told Noah, he's like, hey, I'm going to destroy the earth because everyone's so, their hearts are wicked, right? And can you imagine how scary that was? But then God told Noah, he said, because you're a good man and you love me and you obey me and you follow my ways, I need you to build an ark. I'm going to save you and your family, right? And you could imagine, I think this ark, from what I understood, it was like over 450 feet long. Can you imagine? And Angel and I went to see a really cool documentary about just some historical things about the ark, and it was pretty amazing. But so can you imagine what people were saying to Noah when they're like, what are you doing? And he's like, I'm building an ark. God's going to destroy the world. And they thought he was crazy, right? And they were making fun of him. I mean, how much did that take for him to trust God? Everybody around you was making fun of you. And can you imagine how exhausted he was and how long that took? And but he trusted. He trusted. And one of the cool parts about the ark is that, you know, that ark didn't have a steering wheel or a rudder. When they were, so not only did he trust God to build the ark, but he trusted God the whole time when it was like, we don't know where this thing's going, where it's going to land. He trusted in God. And guess what? God said, he did what he said he was going to do, right? He saved them. He saved them. So, yeah, pretty cool story. So he trusted in God. That's a pretty good example. How about Simon Peter when he's fishing? This is just a kind of a small thing, but it shows you too that we got to trust him with the small things and the big things. So the story is that, you know, Simon Peter's out fishing and he's a professional fisher, right? So he knows, he kind of knows where all the fish are. I don't know, the areas to fish. And he's out fishing all night. And then Jesus comes in the boat, right? And he's talking to people and teaching. And then at the end he says, and they weren't catching any fish. He was tired and exhausted. And then Jesus tells him, he's like, hey, go throw your net over there, right? And then Simon's like, we've been out here all night, probably no fish. But then what does he say? What does he do? He obeys. He says, but I'm going to listen to you. And he did. And then everybody know that story. He caught so many fish that they could barely even carry him in. It was almost breaking the nets. They had fish and fish and fish and fish. So he trusted in God, right? Something even little like that. God directed his ways. How about the story about the woman with the issue of blood, with the infirmity, right? She was sick. She was super sick. She had an infirmity spirit and was bleeding for 12 years. And she spent all her money to go to doctors and all the different things that she could think of. And she was super desperate, right? So she knew, she trusted, she said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, just a tiny little piece of Jesus, I trust that he can heal me, right? And I think about, like, do we have trust like that? Like, do we have trust like that? I don't know. I fall short a lot. I don't know. But guess what? She went out, stepped out in faith. She took action. She trusted, and she was healed instantly, right? So that's kind of a cool story, too. So, So before I play this video, I wanted to just point out again, so what's, there's something in common with all of these stories is that those people took action. They were obedient, right? They listened to God. They trusted in him. And it turned out okay. It didn't mean it was easy, right? These people went through some hard times. So again, faith, the faith they had, faith is our belief and our trust is an action. So that woman put her faith into action, right? She walked out the walk. Okay, here's a cute little cartoon. Even if you're older, it's cute. But this is just kind of illustrates that story about Daniel and his friends, what happened when they got put in the fiery furnace, okay? So it's about 3 minutes long, 3.5 minutes. Oh, I forgot, I had to do it over here.
Stories of the Bible.
Can you hear it? Can you make it?
There once higher? Were three Jewish men named Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. When they were very young, they were taken to Israel to live in a place called. At that time, the king of Babylon was a man named Nebuchadnezzar.
That's it. Almost there.
And he made a gold statue that was 90 feet tall.
It's okay.
The king sent a message for everyone to come to the dedication of this statue. When everyone had assembled, it was declared that people of all races, nations, and languages would bow before the statue and worship King Nebuchadnezzar's statue. When they heard the sound of musical instruments, if anyone refused, they would be thrown into a fiery furnace. So at the sound of the musical instruments, all people bowed to the ground and worshiped Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, because they were Jewish and would only bow to the one true God. Some of the wise men of Babylon went to the king and told him that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow to the statue. This made the king very angry, and he asked Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego if it was true that they would not bow to the statue. Then he said he would give them one more chance to bow down, and if they did not bow, they will be thrown into the fire. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied that they didn't need to defend themselves against the king. They said, if we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. But even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue you have set up. The king was so angry with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that he commanded the furnace to be heated 7 times hotter than usual. Then he ordered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to be bound and thrown in the fire. The fire was so hot that it killed the soldiers that threw them in. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego fell into the flames. But suddenly, the king jumped up and said to his advisors, "Didn't we tie up 3 men and throw them in the furnace?" The advisor said, "Yes." But the king said, "Look, I see 4 men walking around the fire and the fourth looks like a god." Then the king shouted to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, "Come out!" So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stepped out of the fire, and everyone saw that the fire had not touched them. They didn't even smell of smoke. Then Nebuchadnezzar praised the one true God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who had rescued them from the fire. And the king made a new command that anyone who spoke a word against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would be greatly punished. Then he promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in his court. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego trusted in God and were willing to die rather than worship any god but their own god.
Kind of a cool story, huh? The one thing I want to point out in the video, just to clarify too, is that in the video it says, like, hey, we think there's a god in there, but we know that was Jesus, right? Pretty sure that was Jesus. So, Wrong one. So again, they put their trust. That shows us that sometimes we're going to have to make some really tough decisions about trusting God, right? Okay, so one of the last slides in here is I just So sometimes think like, okay, we know what we need to do. And sometimes there's times where we feel really, really strong and really connected to God. And then there's sometimes where we feel like, gosh, I don't know. What do I need to do? I need some help, Lord. And so a couple ideas for just some short prayers, right, to help increase our trust in Jesus. And especially for the kids, you know, sometimes when we talk to God, it doesn't need to be some really, really long, really impressive prayer, right? God hears our prayers, and He loves your prayers. And so sometimes you can just say, Lord, help me obey You when I don't understand, right? Because sometimes, let's be honest, we don't understand. We don't understand. If someone's sick or someone dies or things like that, or we're going through a really hard time, it's hard to understand, right? Especially when we're kids. We don't need to understand all those things, right? But we can just say, Lord, help me to trust You. Help me to obey You when I don't understand. And then, Lord, help me to surrender what I can't control. Anybody have a hard time surrendering? Want to be in control of things? It feels good, right? When we feel like we have control. And there's some things that we can control, right? We can control what we're, how we're reacting to people and how we're responding or if we're taking offense. But there's some things that are out of our control, right? Especially as kids. There's things that might be going on in our families that we can't control. So sometimes we need to just say, Lord, help me to surrender that. So we do what we can, and then we pray it to the Lord to do what He's going to do, okay? He'll take care of the rest. He does every time, I promise. And then the last one is, Lord, help me trust You when life hurts the most, right? So we talked about that earlier, like it's easy to be filled with trust and joy when things are going really, really well. But sometimes when we're really hurting, when something bad happens, it's hard, right? So we can, and God knows that, and He cares, right? He wants to help us. So we can just say, Lord, I need Your help. Help me to trust You when things are going bad, when I'm hurting. Okay, we got a couple questions. The other thing I wanted to mention is that we talked about at the beginning, I don't know if everybody was here, but when we talked about the character of God and we talked about where do we look for all this information, we look to the Bible, right? And I want to make sure, so if you guys don't have a Bible, will you come tell me after? Because I have some Bibles. And I'd love to give, you have one? That's awesome.
No, we have three.
That's even better. That's even better. So if you don't have a Bible, come talk to us after, okay? Because I brought some Bibles, and I'd love to give you guys one. So you going to ask some questions? We got a couple questions to ask, and they're going to be really hard. You ready? No, they're not going to be really hard. Okay, you want to ask them? Here, you do the clicker. So just do, one will just come up at a time. Okay, there's just a couple, and this is it. All right.
What is one reason I should trust in Jesus?
Because He's the Son of God.
Pfft, slam dunk. There we go. That's great, right?
Yeah.
Can trust in Him. Because all the Scripture says we can trust in Him, right? And He's our Savior. He loves us.
Who am I serving if I'm not serving Jesus?
The devil.
Yes.
Man, that's great.
What was one story we talked about of people trusting in Jesus?
Yeah, he said the fiery furnace. And you know what's cool? Those were just a couple. There's so many cool stories in the Bible. We have a really cool Bible at home. What's that called? Just this, the green one. That the stories,
yeah,
breaks it down. The story, there's just story. So there's that one, but then we have one, it's a little bit more adult friendly, but it's just shorts. Yeah, the adventure one's cool because then you get to, you know all those, read those, because then you get to know all these cool stories about people in the Bible. They are, yep. Sometimes the words are confusing, and so we can ask parents, and we can ask God to explain that to us, right? But keep reading it anyways. Okay, is there another one?
Who does not want us to trust in Jesus?
Yeah. Yeah.
Very close. I think there's one.
Yeah, yeah.
What's one thing that happens if we don't trust in Jesus?
We'll end up with a bad wife.
Yeah.
I end up in hell.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very good.
I know those are big, big things to talk about, but they're really important, right? Yeah. Yeah. And you're so right. Our whole life, right? Things spiral out of control. Things get really, really, really hard. So that's all that I have for today. I'm so thankful that you guys came and you were patient and you listened. And I hope you got something out of there. It sounds like you guys are already know a lot of this stuff. And the reason why I think these children's services are good too is when I started sitting in on them, directed to the kids. But boy, isn't it something that we can all take away? Sometimes we've got to, especially as adults, no matter how far along we are in our walk with God, we got to bring it back to the basics, right? Anybody ever heard that term, right? Because if we're not just trusting in Jesus and we don't know what God says about us and we don't know our identity and we don't know the Bible, it's so important to read the Bible. Because guess what? If we read the Bible and we know what Scripture says and we know these stories, it's going to be less likely that we get deceived, right? But we get tricked when we don't know, because then we say, oh, is that what God said? Is that what? Oh. So we got to be rooted in Scripture. We got to read, we got to know the Bible. We got to know those stories, right? So we know, so we can be walking and trusting with God. So we're done for now. What we'd like to do from here is if anybody would like some prayer, we have some people here that are really strong prayer warriors and would love to pray with you guys and talk with you, okay? So we're going to turn off the camera. And I brought, like I said, if you don't have a Bible, but also we brought some really cool bracelets that just say, like, Jesus loves you, which is super important to remember, right? So we've got a whole bunch of them. So you can come grab some if you want to bring some for your friends or your brothers and sisters or anybody that, your mom or dad or anybody. So we've got some of those.
Out for the weekends, but he's not coming back till Tuesday, so I'll grab one for him as a supply.
That would be a great idea. That sounds awesome. Cool. Okay, well, thank you so much for coming. Can I just close in prayer really quick? And then if you guys want to stick around, we'd love to pray for you. So, Lord, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to have these children and these parents here, Lord. And we just pray that you bless them, Lord. We pray that you lead them, Lord, that they can trust you. We pray, Lord, that they can put their trust in you even when it's really, really hard things, Lord, because we know you love them so much. And we can just learn so much from these kids, Lord. You tell us to have childlike faith, Lord. So we pray that you just bless them as they leave here today, Lord, that you put a hedge of protection around them, Lord, and help just help imprint it into all of us, Lord, to trust you more and to look at our walk with you, Lord. And so we pray for those that are hurting right now, Lord, and need some healing and deliverance, Lord. We just pray for everybody as they leave here today. We thank you and we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. That's it.